So we all know that the water that is available that supports the growth. So more the water, more will be the growth of microorganism. For example, the good example is you have milk. Milk which has more water will cause more deterioration very easily. So it is a measure of how efficiently the water present can take part in a chemical reaction. So if in a system, if the half of the water is tightly bound to a protein molecule that could not take part in a hydrolysis reaction, the water activity would be reduced. For example, this is a milk. Okay, so if it is 100 ml of milk, I evaporate the 50% of water into it, and only half of the portion of this is remained, in which you have more concentrated protein molecule. So it will be the water activity of this concentrated milk would be lesser compared to the original milk. So water activity is nothing but the partial pressure of water above the food and the pure solution. So here water activity is equal to P divided by P0, where P and P0 are the partial pressure of water above the food and a pure solution under identical conditions respectively. Okay, so P is the partial pressure of water above the food and P0 is the pure solution under. So pure solution is your water. Okay. So water has a water pure water has a water activity value of 1. Okay, that means 100% of water. Okay, as a solution of food becomes more concentrated, this P value obviously decreases because you take the water and add sugar or salt, so this water gets bound, it's not no more free water, so therefore this P value get decreased, and therefore the water activity obviously falls from near the maximum value of the one. So it will go 0.8, 0.7, 0.6, and so on and so forth. So for pure water, it is one value, and in the absence of capillary or, of course, adsorptive forces. The water activity is thus equivalent to the relative humidity of atmosphere in equilibrium with the solution. And it is expressed as a ERH. Okay, so it is very equivalent to the relative humidity of the atmosphere. So equilibrium, this equilibrium relative humidity of a atmosphere in equilibrium. So it is called as a ERH. Equilibrium relative humidity is equal to whatever water activity into 100, water activity multiplied by 100 will give you equilibrium relative humidity. So water activity in a food system can be decreased by substances that dissolve in water. Okay. This water activity can be decreased. So as I gave you an example, if suppose this is a pure water, okay, pure water, and you add sugar, what happened? This water activity will be decreased. Okay. Solutes decreases the vapor pressure so that fewer molecules go into the air above the solution or food. The atmosphere above such food would have a lower relative humidity than air above the pure water or food with a high pressure, high vapor pressure, that is low solid content. So sucrose appreciably decreases the water activity of food system because its molecular size is relatively small. Dextrose, you have sodium chloride, they will all reduce the water activity even more because of their low molecular size. So sorption isotherm, what is sorption isotherm? The food sorption isotherm describes the thermodynamic relationship between water activity and the equilibrium of the moisture content of a food product at a constant temperature and constant pressure. So the knowledge and understanding of the sorption isotherm is important in food science and technology, because water activity or this presence of water itself is a very, very important phenomenon. And when we are playing with the water activity, we want to decrease the water activity to increase the shelf life, and then therefore this is nothing but this sorption isotherm will give you an idea about the relationship between this water activity and equilibrium of the moisture content of a food product, because the food product has a moisture content and you are trying to decrease it. So you are trying to find out what is happening, the relationship. Okay, water activity means the water present, whether it is free water, bound water or whichever water, and the food product, okay, at a constant temperature. Then only we will decide that, okay, this temperature and this time is sufficient to get this quality of the product. But particularly dehydrated food product, you know, suppose I have spinach leaves, okay, I want to dehydrate these leaves. So what will happen? Initially, the moisture content is greater than 90. So there will be more moisture loss, rapid moisture loss will be there. And then slowly, slowly, the all moisture loss will take place. But what is the, and this will suppose if I am drying it at 80 degrees Celsius. So if I dry it at 80 degrees Celsius for 4 hours, what is the effect on textural quality? If I dehydrate it at 60 degrees Celsius for maybe more hour, 6 hours, what is the effect on the textural quality? Suppose if I am dehydrating it at a 40 degrees Celsius, maybe for 12 hours, what is the effect on the textural quality? So basically, this sorption isotherm will give me an idea, especially the thermodynamic relationship between what is happening with the water, free water, or the water activity, or the free water that is present, and the equilibrium of the moisture content of a food product. Okay, equilibrium means beyond that moisture will not get removed. So the knowledge and understanding of sorption isotherm is very, very important in food science and technology for design and optimization of a drying equipment. So I do not know at what temperature I should dry my vegetable, how much packages, what is the layer, what should be the size, what is the quality I'm going to get, whether 40 degrees Celsius, but in general, in the industry, the time is very important. Lesser the time is better. So if I am dehydrating at 60 degrees Celsius and 6 hours, and 40 degrees Celsius, 12 hours. So if there is no difference, if the quality is not affected, I will obviously go, because here the time is very, very important. Going beyond, if I dehydrate my product at 80 degrees Celsius within 4 hours and still there is no change, either the textural quality or sensorical acceptability, then I will go for this, because I am saving my lot of time. Okay, so this sorption isotherm will give you an idea about the shelf life, the quality of the product with respect to specific, you know, temperature, time, and calculation of moisture changes that may occur during the storage. So several preservation processes have been developed in order to prolong the shelf life of the product by lowering the availability of water to microorganisms and inhibiting some chemical reactions. So the typical shape of an isotherm that reflects the way in which the water binds the system. Weaker water molecule interactions generate a greater water activity, thus product becomes more unstable. Water activity depends on the composition, temperature, physical state of the compound. That I gave you already a lot of example. Na? Carrot, its composition is different. Therefore, water activity is different for the carrot. So if you have milk, everything. Okay, so each product has a physical state which is different. That therefore, the water activity will be different. So this sorption isotherm can be generated from an adsorption process or desorption. Adsorption means adsorption, okay? And desorption means you are giving out the moisture and absorbing the moisture. Giving out the moisture and absorbing the moisture. So this difference between these curves are defined as hysteresis, okay? The difference between the curves are, so I think I have seen, this is like, you see, this is an adsorption. Okay. So water activity, what is happening? This is a water activity. So this is the moisture content. So moisture content is, here is less. So it is increasing. It is going towards the water activity one means it is a pure water means it is, and then you have this desorption, okay, and hysteresis is the difference between these two. Water adsorption by food product is a process in which water molecule progressively and reversibly mix together with the food solid via either chemisorption method or physical adsorption method, or there is a multilayer condensation. An isotherm can be typically divided into three regions. The water in region A represents strongly bound water, and the enthalpy of vaporization is considerably higher than the one of the pure water. The bound water includes structural water, that is H-bonded water, and the monolayer water, which is solved by the hydrophilic and polar groups of food components, for example, polysaccharides, proteins, etc. We have already seen bound water is an unfreezable water and it is not available for the chemical reaction or as a plasticizer also. So when you look, see, this is a A zone, and then this is a B zone, and this is the C zone. In this region, the B region, the water molecule bind less firmly than in the first zone. It is obviously, see here. They usually present in the small capillary. The vaporization enthalpy is slightly higher than one of the pure water. The class of constituent water can be looked upon as the continuous transition from bound water to free water takes place. The properties of water in region C are very similar to those of the free water, because see, you are going near to the one. One is a nothing but 100% of water, pure water. So therefore, the water in the region C are similar to those of the free water, that is held in voids, large capillaries, cervices. And the water in this region is obviously loosely binds to the food material. And also this hysteresis is related to the nature and the state of components of a food that reflecting their potential for structural and conformational rearrangement. For example, if I gave you earlier example, spinach, okay, or methi. So I have, for the preservation purpose, I have removed the moisture using, suppose I use 80 degrees Celsius for 4 hours and then I dehydrate. So I want to rehydrate, okay, rehydrate means I want them back to the original fresh, like obviously it is not possible to get and make them similar to the fresh spinach, but here will be, you know, we can find that the nature and the state of the component of the food, like the cellulosic material. Suppose, you know, I have a very immature leaf or a very matured leafy vegetable. So the nature and state of components, they will obviously, you know, affect on this process, reflecting their potential for structural and conformational rearrangement, which alters the accessibility of energetically favorable polar sites. Okay, so do you all agree that suppose, you know, if I have an immature spinach leaves and I dehydrate them, the structure and nature and the bonding between the molecules will be different compared to that of, suppose these are like yellow color, like little bit, you know, matured leaves. So that will alter the accessibility of energetically favorable polar sites. The presence of capillaries in food results in considerable decrease in water activity. So effect of water on, how does this water affect on the quality of food? So there will be change in physical properties, microbial properties, chemical properties. So let's understand what is the physical properties that are like the effect of water or effect on quality of this food. So what are the physical aspects? So food products are classified in many ways. One such classification is based on its water content. Water content, one of the important quality required to judge the acceptance of any food product. Suppose you go to the market, okay, and if you want to buy the apples, which one would you buy? The one that are very fresh and juicy. Same is for example, methi or spinach or coriander leaves you want to buy, the one that looks very green, fresh, juicy, only you will buy that. Okay, so this, because the water content is very, very important quality parameter to decide the quality. For example, you know, the cucumber has also a lot of water content. So if you, you know, see that there are cucumbers which are shrunken and they have lost the moisture content, will you choose that or you will choose the one that is very, very fresh? Okay, so every product will be able to maintain the quality and texture with the required amount of water content in them. Increase or decrease of its water content makes it unacceptable. So very high water foods, the water content, based on the water content, the foods have been categorized: very high water foods, high water foods, medium water foods, low water foods, very low water foods, and dehydrating foods, okay, or zero water foods. Okay, so very high water foods, like example is in our day-to-day life, we have soups, we have curries, we have dals, then we have broths, stews, sauces, gravies, sprouts, non-starchy vegetables, like your spinach, methi, vegetables, all other vegetables like green onion, juices, milk, paneer, soya paneer or tofu or rice milk or almond milk or peanut milk, all type of milk, raw fruits and juices. So high water foods are like the water containing foods ranging between 65% to 80%. Okay, so starchy vegetables and fruit, baked or broiled fish, rice, beans, yogurt, roasted chicken, turkey, potatoes, cottage cheese, beef, all that will be categorized. So medium water foods will be 50% to 65%. The example would be cooked medium, breaded, fried fish, fried chicken, cooked grains, beans. These are some of the names that are not consumed by us. But you can say most of the natural cheeses or sandwich meats, etc. Okay. So low water foods, which has moisture content ranging between 30 to 50%. So this will come under, like, you have these hamburgers, processed cheese, cheddar cheese, then you have most of the bread, chapatis, cooked rice, salad dressings. They will come all under these categories: French fries or bondas, pakoras. Very low water foods, like you have the water content ranges for this category of food between 15% to 30%. So example are your jams, jellies. So now you see the moment the water content is decreased, the shelf life. So jam at least have a very high shelf life. Cakes also better than, of course, bread. Then dried fruits, molasses, pastries, sweet rolls, mayonnaise, syrups. So the water content is between 15% to 30%. And then you have this last is the category which has moisture content less than 15%. Okay. So the example are your cookies, pretzels, popcorns, dried snacks, chips, pasta, most of the candies, flour, dry cereals, chocolates, nuts, peanut butter. And then there is a last category called as a less than 1% water, but still there is a water, like sugar, salt, lard or pure fat or pure oil, that all comes under zero water food. Then after physical aspect, there is also microbial aspect. So microorganisms require minimum water activity for their growth and other metabolic activities. So below are the list of, like, various microorganisms. They have a different the water activity. So here also, like in the table, I have tried to include. So if you look at the water activity, which is like almost very high, not one is your pure water, okay? So just below this one is 0.9. The fresh meat, fruit, vegetable, cooked sausages, cheese, all of them comes under like a high moisture containing food, okay? So the microorganism that can grow in this water activity or a high moisture food is Clostridium botulinum, perfringens, Bacillus cereus, Salmonella, L. monocytes, Vibrio cholera. These are some of the microorganisms and which are dangerous also that grow in these food products which has a high moisture content. Now the water activity is little bit decreased, like you have 0.88, but still there are some agents which can still grow. For example, sweetened condensed milk, fruit juice, concentrate, chocolate syrup, fruit cake, dried meats, all of them will have a growth of Staph aureus, which is like a that will produce a toxin called as a Clostridium botulinum, which produce botulin, S. aureus, which is also will produce some toxin. Most of the mold like Aspergillus species, Penicillium species, Bisoclampus species, yeast, they will all cause the growth of the microorganism. Okay, these will all cause the spoilage of this food, Saccharomyces species. Then you have the next is water activity is 0.71. And the typical products are jam, marmalade, glazed fruit, salted fish, etc. And the microorganism that will grow is mold, Aspergillus flavus or Aspergillus niger are the example. Then further decrease in the water activity. Now moisture is decreasing. Okay. So you see the number here, these are very common. The number is decreasing. Okay. So mold can grow only in the water activity of 0.71. So example of jam, you see the jam has a quite high shelf life, but still mold can cause the growth of these, the spoilage of this jam and marmalade. Then water activity of 0.60, you have dried fruit, corn syrup, marshmallow, chewing gum, and osmophilic yeast, that is, this roxy can also grow. So below that certain level, you see no microbial proliferation, So milk powder, crackers, cake mixes, whole egg powder, caramel, toffee, honey. If you maintain the water activity, there will be no growth. Okay. So what are the chemical changes? So this is a very, very complex graph that you see, because there are lots of chemical changes that are taking place at the background. So water activity will not only just affect on, we saw that how it affects on the textural quality or shelf life of the food product in terms of microbial quality, but it also affects on there are a lot of chemical changes, okay, taking place behind. So water is the biological solvent without which many chemical as well as biological reaction would not take place. So if you see, this is a reactive, relative reaction rate, and this is the water activity. So do you see here at the 0.1 water activity, you see there is only like just one change is seen, that is moisture, okay, related to moisture, zone 1. But if you see this zone between 0.7 to 1, water activity, you see mold growth, you see yeast growth, you see bacteria growth, you will also see that the enzyme activity is happening. This is just a moisture, okay, this is the moisture isotherm. But you see, this is the enzyme activity is also increasing. The hydrolytic reactions are also there. Non-enzymatic browning is also there. See? Lipid oxidation. So there are lots of chemical reactions that are taking place. So we know that water is the biological solvent and with which many chemical as well as biological reaction would not take place. तो वन वेरी गुड एग्जाम्पल इज लिपिड ऑक्सीडेशन. इन इन वट लेक्चर आई एम गोइंग टू टीच यू हाउ वट इज लिपिड एंड सो लिपिड ऑक्सीडेशन रेफर्स टू द ऑक्सीडेटिव डिग्रेडेशन ऑफ लिपिड्स. इट इज द प्रोसेस इन विच फ्री रेडिकल स्टील द इलेक्ट्रॉन्स फ्रॉम द लिपिड्स इन सेल मेम्ब्रेन रिजल्टिंग इन टू द सेल डैमेज. ओके this process proceeds by a free radical or chain reaction mechanism. It most often affects polyunsaturated fatty acid because they contain multiple double bond. We know that there are two types of fatty acid, saturated fatty acid and unsaturated fatty acid. Saturated fatty acid means they are saturated, okay? There is no double bond, so therefore it is not possible and they are very intact. They are so packed. For example, all, you know, ghee or solid fat. It is a solid. It is because the intermolecular hydrogen bonding is very strong. There is no hydrogen bond. But in this, they are separated. The molecules are separated because of the presence of the hydrogen bond. More the double bond, more is the unsaturation. So this is poly. Poly unsaturated means more double bond. More double bond. So if a molecule has a more double bond, okay, so if you have more double bond, what will happen? The molecule will get, you know, oxidized very easily. The free radical can attack onto it and it can cause the oxidation. Then non-enzymatic browning, it is also otherwise called as a Maillard reaction, and we have seen it is very very common. It is a Maillard reaction otherwise, like during the baking. So it is a reaction between amino group which is present in protein and a carbonyl group which is present in a reducing sugar. So for example, you have seen this Maillard reaction most commonly baking. So for example, bread. So bread has this, you know, crust portion. This white portion is called as a crumb and this brown portion is called as a crust. So crust is, you know, brown in color is because of the Maillard reaction, because there is a protein. So you have protein with the amino group and a sugar with, especially reducing sugar with the carbonyl group. So this Maillard reaction is nothing but a reaction between the protein and reducing sugar. So reducings are those, we know that reducing are those with the free aldehyde or keto group, glucose, lactose. So it is mainly used for flavor development in the food industry. You know, now bread is very much like, and the crust has a special taste. Suppose you are making cookies, okay? Cookies also taste very good when, you know, there is more like Maillard reaction has happened. So it is mainly used for flavor development in many food industry, like bread industry. Color flavor is developed using Maillard reaction. So it is also noted that at higher temperature, Maillard reaction result into formation of. There are some reports that this Maillard reaction there results into formation of acrylamide in food, which is a potent carcinogen. There are also research being carried out to reduce the level of acrylamide in food without compromising on quality. So a variety of yeast has been developed which can reduce the acrylamide produced in baked product, and they are able to reduce nearly 95% of acrylamide within 1 hour. It is also noted that reaction rate non-enzymatic browning is rapid between 0.5 to 0.7, and below this is the rate decreases with the decrease in water activity. Enzymatic browning is nothing but is a chemical process which involves polyphenol oxidases, catechol oxidases, and other enzymes. You know, in all the fruits and vegetables, suppose you have this apple, when you cut the apple immediately and you keep it outside, and after some time you will see that the apple has become literally, you know, brown. The slices of this apple have become brown in color is because this apple has a lot of polyphenol and also the enzyme polyphenol oxidase. So these enzyme will act on the substrate and they will result into formation of a complex compound which will result into melanoidins or quinine, which is converted to melanins, and these compounds are responsible for giving the brown colors. Okay, so this is the reaction or a chemical process rather, which involves polyphenol oxidase, catechol oxidase and other enzymes that create melanins and benzoquinone from natural phenols, which result into a brown color. Enzymatic browning generally requires exposure to oxygen. Thus, the browning that occurs when an apple, for example, is cut. And this is seen in many other also, like you have brinjal, you have potatoes and others. Okay, so polyphenol oxidase convert the polyphenol present in the food to quinine, which is then converted to melanins, responsible for this browning of the fruits and vegetable, and usually potatoes, apple, banana, you see this browning. Okay, so with respect to water activity, enzymatic browning reduces with the decrease in the water activity. Generally, blanching is performed to inactivate the enzyme so that this enzymatic browning can be inhibited. Effect of water on preservation of food. Drying occurs by effecting vaporization. So what is the water on preservation of food? Drying, we do the drying. So drying occurs by affecting the vaporization of the liquid by supplying heat to the wet feedstock. For example, dehydrated methi or dehydrated spinach, dehydrated lettuce finger, dehydrated potatoes, dehydrated cabbage. You see nowadays there are a lot of dehydrated vegetables available. So heat may be supplied by convection, that is direct dryer, or by conduction or contact or indirect dryer. So drying is used to remove water from foods for two reasons: to prevent or inhibit microorganism and hence preserve the food, and to reduce the weight and bulk of the food. So water is the culprit. We saw that how the presence of water can influence the growth of microorganisms. Therefore, water is one of the very important factors. Okay. So if you remove the water, the shelf life will be increased. Very simple. And there are a lot of dryers which can be used. So either you perform direct dryers or you perform indirect dryers. Okay. So drying is used basically to remove the water from the food. Basically, we remove the water to decrease the water activity so that the microorganism growth is inhibited and the product is preserved for long. And when there is a scarcity of those, for example, you know, amba poli or amba vadi or slices of mango or slices of seasonal fruits, like mango is a very, very seasonal one. So even, you know, in the off season like this, you will find that the mangoes can be made available if they are dehydrated and kept. Okay, so when carried out correctly, the nutritional quality, color, flavor and texture of dehydrated foods are obviously slightly less than the fresh food, but most of the people this has only minor nutritional. So suppose, you know, now some of you want to eat mango slices, and it's okay if you do not get, you know, the full nutrition content, but little less nutrition content if it is there, that is absolutely okay. So drying methods and processes can be classified in several different ways. So it can be classified as a batch, where the material is inserted into a drying equipment and drying proceeds for a given period of time, or as a continuous, where the material is continuously added to the dryer and dried material continuously removed. So drying processes can also be categorized according to the physical conditions used to add heat and remove the water vapor. In the first category, heat is added by a direct contact with heated air at atmospheric pressure, and the water vapor formed is removed by the air. In vacuum drying, the evaporation of water proceeds more rapidly at low pressure, and the heat is added indirectly by contact with the metal wall or by radiation. Low temperatures can also be used under vacuum for certain material that may discolor or decompose at a high temperature. So again, this is again the drying rate at a temperature, and these are like how the moisture content of the product. So as you have the drying rate or temperature increase, the moisture content decreases. This green color. So this is percent moisture content of the product. So product temperature might initially it will absorb the temperature and it will remain constant in this stage, and then maybe little increase, but there is no much change. So drying occurs in three different period or phases, which can be clearly defined here. The first phase or the initial period. What happens in the initial phase? The sensible heat is transferred to the product. So initially you have this product, okay, suppose the vegetables are kept. So initially the heat is transferred to the product and the contained moisture. So suppose these are the slices of the potato. So what happens, initially the heat will be transferred to the moisture content, that is, and mostly free. The second phase or constant rate period is when the free moisture persists on the surfaces. So what will happen, suppose this is the thickness of the slice, okay, potato slice, then it will, the on the top of the, there will be moisture. So initial case that will be removed. Then at this level, then what will happen, this moisture will come on the upper layer. So is when the free moisture which is persist on the surfaces and the rate of evaporation alters very little, because you have already evaporated the top layer's moisture content and this other one has also come. So it is called as a constant rate period when the free moisture persists on the surface and the rate of evaporation alters very little. The third phase is called as a falling rate period. It's the phase during which migration of moisture from the inner interstices of each particle to the outer surface becomes the limiting factor that reduces the drying rate. Okay, so this has come here, and then it is the phase during which migration of moisture from the inner interstices of each particle to the outer surface becomes the limiting factor that reduces the therefore drying rate. Okay, so there are types of dryers like tray dryers. In these types of dryers, the food is spread out generally quite thinly on trays in which the drying takes place. Heating may be by an air or current sweeping across the tray, by conduction from heated trays or heated shelves on which the tray lies, or by radiation from heated surfaces. And most tray dryers are heated by air, which also removes the moist vapor. Application is, this dryer can be utilized for drying many different crops, and these they commonly are used for dry fruit, vegetable pieces, depending upon the food and desired final moisture content. So drying time may be of the order of 10 or even 20 hours. Freeze drying is also called as a lyophilization or cryodesiccation. It's again a dehydration process, but it's very expensive. It also takes a lot of time, and it's used for the material which are very expensive, and the volatiles gets affected if you tray dry them or if you use the high temperature. So very, very delicate food constituent would be then dehydrated using freeze drying. Obviously, the quality which is obtained in this dehydrated product is higher. So the material is held onto the shelves or bales in a chamber that is under high vacuum. And in most of the cases, the food is frozen before being loaded into the dryer. So directly, the water, free water is converted into ice, and then ice is sublimed, sublimation takes place. And heat is transferred to the food by conduction or radiation, and vapor is removed by vacuum pump, and then it is condensed. So most of the cases, the application of this freeze drying is for freeze dry instant coffee, because coffee has that lot of polyphenol, tannins, and flavoring compound, and one do not want to lose those. Vegetables for dried soup mixes, mushrooms, herbs, spices, cheese streams, fruits for ready-to-eat breakfast cereals. Then spray drying is also one of the very, very well-known technique that is being used for dehydration, and generally liquid or fine solid material in the form of slurry are sprayed in the form of fine droplet, like generally like this is the, there is a nozzle, and through this nozzle the material is, you know, fed. Suppose this is your milk, okay, and through this pipe, feed rate pipe, this is called as a nozzle, and this nozzle has a hole, and this milk will be sprayed into very 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 very, very small droplets, and the temperature, and there is a, this is called as a drying zone or a drying hub, and here there is, you know, nozzle. So from here the milk is supplied, and then a nozzle spreads, you know, the milk into small droplets, and these droplets are, you know, the temperature of these ranges between 180 to 200 degrees Celsius, and through vacuum, these dried powder, which are, you know, in the form of very small droplets, which are directly dried quickly in the fraction of seconds, and then they are with the vacuum, they are collected here in the form of spray-dried powder. So basically, fine droplet dispersion into a current of heated air, and air and solid may move in a parallel or counterflow direction, and drying occurs very rapidly, so that this process is very useful for material that are damaged by exposure to heat. For example, milk casein or milk flavors will not get, you know, affected here. So the our drier body is large, so that the particles can settle, and as then they dry without touching the wall on which they might otherwise stick. Commercial dryers can be very large, of order of 10 meter diameter and 20 meter high. Application: spray drying is a very widely applied technical method which is used to dry aqueous or organic solvents, emulsions in industrial chemistry and food industry. Dry milk powder, detergents, dyes are just few spray dried products currently available. Spray drying can be also used to preserve the food or simply as quick drying method. It also provides the advantage of weight and volume reduction. It is the transformation of feed from a fluid state into a dried particulate form by spraying the feed into a hot drying medium. Fluidized bed dryer, it combines a perforated plate with a regulated airflow rate such that the solid particles become suspended about the plate, and these dryers can be operated in a batch. Again, you know, fluidized bed dryer, you have these okay, so here the air current is passed through, and then, you know, desiccated coconut, so because of the hot air current, it gets circulated, and then it gets dehydrated. Fluid bed drying is suited for powders, granules, agglomerates and pellets with an average particle size which is normally between 50 and 5000 micron. Very fine light powders or highly elongated particles may require vibration for successful fluid bed drying. Defects, loss in nutrition, flavor, texture, case hardening may also take place when the drying is rapid and fast. The surface of food gets dried, whereas the inner core of the product remains undried. It is called as a case drying, case hardening. Through freezing also, one can freeze the water and convert the free water into the bound water. So freezing or solidification is a phase transition in which a liquid turns into a solid when its temperature is lowered below its freezing point. All known liquids except liquid helium freeze when the temperature is lowered enough. Liquid helium remains liquid at atmospheric pressure even at absolute zero and can be solidified only under pressure. So for most of the substances, the melting and freezing points are the same temperature. Okay. However, certain substances possesses differing solid-liquid transition temperature. So it is a preservation technique which is achieved by lowering the temperature, reducing the water activity, and increasing the solute concentration. So there are also in the freezing, also there are various types of the freezer. So there you must have heard about slow freezing and quick freezing. So slow freezing is nothing but it is like it's a slow. Okay. So main drawback of this freezer is that the freezing process is very slow, which results in the formation of a large ice crystal. So during thawing, these large ice crystal rupture the cells of the food product, and then it results into loss of texture. So this is generally used for ice creams and transport of frozen products. Quick freezing, like it is called as a quick. Okay. So the because we saw that in the slow freezing there is a drawback. Large ice crystals are formed and then it can damage the texture. So drawback of slow freezing can be then overcome by using this quick freezer. So there results in formation of small ice crystals, which upon thawing does not cause much damage to the food product, and it has improved product quality, like used for unprocessed beef, fish, poultry. And rapid freezing, fluidized bed and cryogenic freezers are like it is used for rapid freezing of food product and is energy intensive. In cryogenic freezer, liquid nitrogen and carbon dioxide are used as a refrigerant. The temperature obtained in this type of freezer is between minus 20 degrees Celsius to minus 50 degrees Celsius, and these are generally used for peas or strawberries. Okay. But there are a lot of problems during freezing, and then here are the some of this problem. It is called as a freezer burn. Is a condition that occurs when frozen food has been damaged by dehydration and oxidation due to air reaching the food, and it is usually induced by substandard or non-airtight packaging. Like for example, if you keep the banana in the refrigerator, there will be freezer burn, or direct in deep freezer if you keep apples, if you keep them in the deep freezer. Drip loss, liquid that exudes from the fish flesh or meat flesh when frozen is meat or fish is thawed, and when it is also called as a thaw drip. And when the drip loss is amount of liquid that is lost is usually, so suppose you have this meat pieces, so the entire free water has been frozen, and when you are thawing, what will happen here also these nutrients also gets, the nutrients are dissolved into the water that is naturally present in the meat tissues. And then when you are thawing, along with this drip loss, the nutrients also gets, like it is a loss. So drip loss is the amount of liquid that is lost and is usually expressed as a percentage of original weight. Apart from this, salt has been used to preserve food items like meat and fish since ages, and we know that pickles are the most famous one in India, which are preserved using salt, and almost 20% of the salt is used for the preservation of pickle. At very high concentration of salt, the cells of the microorganism lose water and dehydrated by the process of osmosis. It also inhibits the growth of bacteria, yeast, mold by the process of osmosis. Salting of meat preserves it for years. During pickling, raw mangoes, tomatoes are also treated with considerably large amount of salt. Okay, so salt is a very good preservative, because it takes out the, it binds with the free water and thus makes it unavailable for the growth of microorganisms. Sugar also plays a similar role. Sugar is a carbohydrate, and the mechanism by which it stores the food is same as that of the salt. And this substance also dehydrates the microorganism by the process of osmosis. And there are two ways in which the foodstuffs can be stored, like jelly, jam, marmalade. You add a lot of sugar, so candied or glazed fruit, and all these could be stored because the free water is converted into bound water. So intermediate moisture foods are the foods which have moisture content higher than that of the dry food and are edible without rehydration. Despite their high moisture content, they are designated to be shelf stable without needing refrigeration during distribution and storage. The thermal processing to the extent needed for canning is not required, although some intermediate moisture food products may be pasteurized. Intermediate moisture foods have no precise definition based on water content or water activity. Generally, their moisture content ranges between 10 to 40% and water activity ranges between 0.6 to 0.90. So these intermediate moisture foods are also called as IMF food. They are the food product with a very soft texture. They are subjected to one or more technological treatments, consumable without further preparation, and with a shelf stability of several months assured without thermal sterilization, nor freezing or refrigeration, but by an adequate adjustment of their formulations like composition, pH, additives, and mainly water activity, which must be approximately between 0.6 and 0.84. OK, okay, that is generally measured at, which is measured at 25 degrees Celsius. So the characteristic properties of these IMF food offer a very, very different number of advantages over the conventional one, like dry or high moisture foods, like intermediate moisture food processing, as well as distribution, generally substantially less energy intensive than drying, refrigeration, freezing, or canning. Also, this IMF technology can potentially lead to a higher retention of nutrients quality than that of the other processing methods of dehydration or thermal processing. So water activity reduction is like in this IMF food, the principal requirement for the production of an IMF is reduction of water activity. So generally, this IMF food has prepared to reduce the water activity. So, and these products, IMF products, are also organoleptically acceptable without further preparation step. So this can be achieved with the addition of humectants, material that lower the water activity, also impart plastic texture, allow the food to retain their moisture property. Okay, so mostly vegetables, meats, fruits could be dried until the moisture content was below 15% to achieve the water activity of about 0.85. Okay, so at this moisture level, rehydration would be required before consumption. Therefore, the use of humectants is fundamental and characteristic step in the production of IMFs, regardless of the specific manufacturing process. A number of hygroscopic chemical compounds have been used or can be considered for use by the food industry as humectants. An effective humectant would be ideally to provide the following property, like shows no toxicity, they exhibit adequate solubility in the water, effectively lower the mole fraction of water, that is, have a low molecular weight, possibly combined with ionic dissociation, show compatibility with the organoleptic characteristics, that is, improve flavor or impart no flavor to IMF products, have low or no calorific value, reinforce dietetic image of the food by adding positive functional property, act as a dietary fiber, a prebiotic or antioxidant component, have low cost food. Ideal humectant would also exhibit synergism with other humectants mostly used for or humectants can be classified like sugars, low molecular weight polyols, protein derivatives, minerals, organic salts, and the commonly consumed humectants are sugar, salt, glycerol, high molecular weight polyols, water soluble gums, amino acids, non-nutritive sweetener. So how is the production of IMF food take place? So partial drying can be used in the production of IMF only if the starting material are naturally rich in humectants. So this is the case with the dried fruit, for example, apricots or raisins, prunes, dates, apples, and figs. They already, their initial content itself is a very high, or maple syrup. The final water activity of this product is in the range of 0.6 to 0.8. Then moist infusion or osmotic dehydration, which involves soaking these solid food pieces in water or humectant solution of a lower water activity. And this technique also being defined as dewatering impregnation soaking. Like you know, na agreka petha, so that in that the pumpkin is, that is koholai we call it, is taken and dipped into the sugar solution of a different strength or different concentration. Okay, so difference in the osmolality forces water to diffuse out of the food into the solution. Simultaneously, the humectants diffuses into the food usually more slowly than the water diffuses out. Obviously, salt or sugar solutions are usually employed, and this is the method for production of candied food also. Novel meat and vegetable IMF products have been produced by these infusion of salt, sugar, glycerol or other humectants. There is also one method is called as a dry infusion method, which consists of you first dehydrate solid food pieces and then you soak them into the water. So that, you know, initially if you soak, it may take more time to remove the water. So basically, you partially remove, maybe you oven dry some of the pumpkin pieces, and then you dip them or soak them into the water humectant solution of the desired water activity. And this process is more energy intensive, but it results into high quality product, and it has been used extensively in the preparation of IMF for the National Aeronautic and Space Administration, that is NASA, and the US military. The latter is major developer and user of these IMF products. The process of direct formulation, which involves baking and direct mixing of food ingredients, humectants, additives, which are followed by cooking, extrusion, or other treatment, resulting in a finished product with the desired water activity. And this method is fast and energy efficient and offers great flexibility in the formulation. It is used for both traditional as well as novel products. So in conclusion, water is very, very essential for ensuring the quality of any food product. And if you control the water content, the microbial growth can also be controlled, and you can extend the shelf life of the product. An intermediate moisture food is a less energy intensive when compared to drying and freezing, and they can be used for making a product quality better than the previous one, that is dry, dehydrated by other drying techniques. So, but understanding the physical and chemical properties of water is very, very important whenever we are studying the food and its processing. So with this, I thank you.